Howdy, and welcome to episode 22 of T-Shirts and Shawls. I'm Karen, and today is Thursday, March 9th, 2017. And I am in a different location of my house shooting this episode of the podcast. One, because I thought I would try out some different lighting, so when I show some things on my iPad, hopefully the glare won't be so bad. And two, because the futon where I normally sit to record is completely covered with boxes full of yarn, and I just really don't feel like moving those right now. So we'll try this out and see how it works. But I have a lot to talk about today, so let's go ahead and get started. Today's shirt is another fairly recent addition to my shirt collection. It is actually one about reading. Let's see if I can get it all. So, sorry, my weekend is all booked. And then a nice stack of books there. And I saw this one come up on T-Fury, so that's where I get most of my shirts. And they have daily shirts of the day. Anyway, so two shirts that they send out emails about each day, and those shirts are usually discounted for that day. So this one came across a couple of weeks ago, and I decided to buy it. And then it turned out really well that it arrived shortly before, I think it arrived last week, and so I was able to wear it on this past Saturday when I went to the North Texas Teen Book Festival. That was in Irving, which at the Irving Convention Center, which is the same place that DFW Fyberfest is now located. So I'm really familiar with the convention center, which made it kind of easier to talk myself into going to this festival, because sometimes I see things that I'd like to go to, but it's at an unfamiliar location, and I don't do well with unfamiliar locations, and so I talk myself out of things. But fortunately, this was in a familiar place. And I had a friend who wanted to go. I am also a copy editor, and I mostly work with self-publishing fiction authors. And so I'm part of an association of editors, and we have a local chapter. And so this is somebody I know through my local chapter. So she and I decided to go to this book festival. And I have to admit that I didn't really know what to expect. I mean, I had looked at the website and kind of glanced at the authors, but especially because it's called the North Texas Teen Book Festival, I really thought it was kind of a local type of thing, that most of the authors would be local authors and maybe it wouldn't be very big. I was completely wrong. First off, the convention center was absolutely packed. I was kind of worried that I wouldn't be able to find my friends. You know, I said, let's meet across from the concession stand. And when I first got there, the place was just absolutely huge crowd, and mostly teenagers. And I have to admit, that was really awesome to see, because we hear so often, well, teens these days, they don't read and they don't do this and blah, blah, blah. Oh my gosh, this giant crowd of teenagers who were so excited to be there and carrying books that they were gonna have signed by the authors. They couldn't wait to hear the authors speak. When we did go to the panels and it was Q&A time, just the sheer number of people who jumped up, teenagers who jumped up and ran to the microphone to line up to ask their questions was just astounding. So that was really exciting. But also I was completely wrong about the authors that they were bringing in. Like I said, I kind of looked at the author list, but I didn't pay super close attention and didn't realize that the authors were coming from all across the United States and even around the world. One of the authors, came from Australia. So, and perhaps she was doing other things while she was in the States. But yeah, she flew from Australia and came to this book festival. So it was a lot bigger than I was expecting. In fact, I didn't quite realize, I saw, okay, there's a kind of first session that is, they didn't call it a keynote, but it was basically a keynote. It was the only session going on starting at 9 a.m. And so my friend and I got to that room about 10 minutes before it was about to start, and the room was already full. And that's when I took a closer look at who it was, and it was a conversation with R.L. Stine. So I can understand that is a big name, why people would be drawn to that. For me, R.L. Stine kind of came, all the goosebumps and all that came out when I was a little bit older, so I kind of missed that whole phenomenon. But it still would have been cool to hear him talk, but we missed out because the room was full. So looking at the next panel that we wanted to go to that started an hour later, we decided, you know what? We don't want to take a chance that that panel is going to be full. It's in the room right next door, so why don't we just go next door and get a seat, and that way we'll be there. And it turns out it was a good thing we did that, because although we had a pretty good selection of seats when we got there, you know, an hour before it started, it did fill up. And I think it was full about 15 minutes before the panel started, maybe even sooner than that. So good thing we went there. That was a panel on dystopian fiction, so all young adult, but young adult. I wish some of the young adult fiction that is available now was available when I was a young adult. So dystopian panel, and one of the big names on that one was Veronica Roth, so the Divergent series. And I think that's what a lot of people in the audience, that's who they were there to see. But one of the other panelists is Victoria Aveyard, which is someone who I didn't make the connection with when I first looked at the list, but I'm actually listening to her books on audiobook right now, and I'll talk about that, the books themselves, in the what I'm reading section. So I'm like, oh, I'm actually reading her books right now. So it was interesting to hear her talk. And then there were a few other people on the panel whose books I haven't read, but based upon what they were talking about, they sounded really interesting. And I will link up in the show notes to the North Texas Teen Book Festival website, and if you're interested, you can look at the authors that were there. And possibly, if you're interested in young adult fiction, get some suggestions for things to read, because I know my to-be-read list has gotten quite long after going to this. So we listened to that panel. Really interesting. Unfortunately, there were way more people who wanted to ask a question than got to ask their question. So a lot of teens were disappointed because we just ran out of time and didn't get to their question. And then after that, there was a panel on fantasy, which we went to. Veronica Roth wasn't on that one. Victoria Aveyard was. And then there were a few other authors, again, that I wasn't familiar with that were on that panel. And I guess it really was the Veronica Roth that really got people in the dystopian one, because in the fantasy one, where she was not there, that room did not fill up. There were quite a few empty seats there, but that was okay. It was a fantastic panel, and the people who weren't there really missed out. I think that almost every author on that panel, their books just sounded so fascinating that I added all of those to my wish list and my to-be-read list. And that was where maybe it was the morning panel that had the Australian author. One of those two panels had the author from Australia, and her books seemed to be about fallen angels. So that seemed really interesting. Anyway, so that panel was neat, and the moderator was really good about getting through questions, and so everyone who got in line for that panel, plus there were, like I said, the crowd was a little smaller in that one, but everyone who got in line to ask a question on that panel did get their question asked. And they came up, these teens came up with some really great questions. So it was exciting to, like I said, to see their enthusiasm. Then we took a break for lunch, and we went back, and I wanted to go to a panel on paranormal fiction, and my friend wanted to go to one on mysteries, so we went to separate panels at that time, and this was in a much smaller room, but the room did fill up, so I'm glad I got a seat. And in that panel, there were four authors, and one of them, I did read one of her books, and then I read half of the next book, and I just kind of got a little bored, and I gave up on it. And she is someone, as a panelist, who takes up perhaps a little bit more than her fair share of time. That's why I'm not really going to name her. So she really kind of talked over a lot of the other people, not necessarily like interrupted them, but she was always the first to jump in and respond and would just kind of talk and talk and talk. And not that she didn't have interesting things to say, but it would have been nice to hear a little bit more from some of the other panelists, especially because one of them, I felt like, ooh, I really think I'm going to like her books. And her name is Kirsten White, and I'll talk about her again in the What I'm Reading section, because one of her books is one that I jumped right into reading as soon as I got home that Saturday. So I would have liked to hear a little bit more from her. Anyway, so that was the paranormal one. And then I decided to, you know, I'm going dystopian, fantasy, paranormal. I might as well kind of keep going in this vein. So they had one on mythology. And so I went to the mythology one, and my friend decided to join me in that one. So she came back in. And that panel, there were two authors on there who are graphic novelists, so who write young adult graphic novels that have to do with mythology. So it was kind of interesting to hear what they had to say, especially talking about not just the writing, but also doing the drawing for their books. And then the author that I really liked from the paranormal panel, Kirsten White, she was also in the mythology one, as well as the Australian author. And I'm sorry, her name completely escapes me right now. So again, I'll link to the show notes, to the North Texas Teen Book Festival, so you can look at the authors. So she was in that panel, as well as another author. And again, their books all sounded really neat, so I'm kind of adding them to the list of books I want to read. And that was it as far as panels. After that there was another kind of keynote, and we decided not to go to that one. We took a stroll around the book sales room, so they had books for sale, and then people were lining up for autographs. So the autograph line was already really, really long. I'm glad we didn't really do the autograph thing, mostly because these days I don't read books very much in physical form. I mostly read on my Kindle. And so I decided not to really buy any physical copies of the books. But we did look at them, go through and look at some of the books, because it's nice to be able to actually, you know, flip through it, read the back cover, for especially those authors that I thought were really interesting. And so we did that, and then that was it. We went home, and I went to Amazon, looked up those authors, added a lot of their books to my books I want to read list, and then immediately purchased one of the books from Kirsten White and started reading it. And I will tell you about that in the What I'm Reading section. So anyway, it was a really, really fun experience. I'm glad that I went. And wore this shirt when I went there. Nobody really said anything about the shirt, but anyway, I enjoyed wearing it. So sorry, my weekend is all booked, and I kind of feel like it kind of got me more excited about reading again. Some, you know, I kind of go through peaks and valleys with reading excitement. So I'm kind of building that excitement back up, and I think this really helped quite a bit. So it was very enjoyable. So for this shawl, I'm not actually going to wear it because it's a shawl I'm really unhappy about. And so I'm just going to show it to you. I was so excited. The shawl that I had been working on for the book on the weekend right after I recorded the last podcast. So I recorded 2 weeks ago on that Thursday. So the very following Saturday, so 2 days later, I finished the knitting part of the shawl. Super excited because I've been so focused on knitting that shawl that I'd put all my other projects aside, and there were other projects I wanted to work on, other things I actually wanted to cast on. And so I was super excited to get it off the needles, and yay, now I'm done and I can work on some other projects and also, you know, move forward with the book. And so Sunday morning, I decided to block it. I was going up to my local yarn shop to meet someone, to give him some yarn. And so I thought, well, I've got a little bit of time this morning, so I'm going to go ahead and block it. And so I took it out and I spread it out on the blocking mat, and I realized that I had made a really, really critical error. So, in knitting it, this is a shawl that has a floral motif. So these are little flowers, they've got the bead that's up at the top. This section, you can see the little flowers growing, and there are the beads. And then here we go, this section, pretty little flowers, lots of beads on that one. And then just kind of a small start down here with these flowers, again, beads showing off kind of where the flower buds would be. So really pretty, right? When you wear it, this is the edge that goes on your neck. Do you notice anything? They're upside down. The flowers are upside down. They should go this way. But when you actually wear it, nope, upside down flowers. Oh, that was not a good realization. I just sat there staring at the blocking mat, thinking, what on earth have I done? I completely forgot to consider the directionality of the shawl. And I started to convince myself, you know, maybe it's not that bad. Maybe people won't notice. Maybe I can just move forward and ignore it. And I did bring it to my knitting group this week on Monday. And I didn't tell them. I just you know, held it up and said, do you notice anything? And they really didn't notice. And even when I pointed out that the flowers were upside down, they didn't seem to think it was that big of a deal. And maybe you agree, maybe you think it's not that big of a deal, but it is, it really is, at least it is to me. It's just, it's wrong. It just feels completely wrong. So you know what that means? All this work, and I do have a pretty shawl. It's just not the shawl that I can use for the book. So I guess I have a pretty shawl for myself, for my shawl collection. And I have a good idea of, you know, the way that the pattern needs to go now. But that means that I need to go revise the pattern and then knit the whole thing all over again. And I have to be completely honest, I do not have it in me right now to knit this entire shawl all over again. I'm so disheartened by this realization, and I was so excited to get to move on to some other projects that I cannot do it. So this shawl is not going to be in the book. It was always kind of a separate part of the book. It didn't really go because the rest of the book is all cowls. So this was kind of a bonus project to begin with. So I don't feel that it is taking away from the book or the idea of the book. So I've decided just to cut it out of the book, and the book will all be the cowls. Which, by the way, all of the patterns are with my tech editor right now. I should be getting them back next week. So I will start looking for test knitters probably next week. But my plan for the shawl is to put this aside. I'm going to revise the pattern. I basically just have to take each chart and flip it. That's the basic thing. The biggest change will be on the edge. What I did is I took the chart that was on the edge, and then I based the border stitches, so kind of creating these little points here. I based those off of where that chart ended. So I'll probably have to redo the border based upon after the chart's flipped, what it looks like. So I'll have to redo the border. And then there is one other section of the shawl that I was a little unhappy with that now I'll get to correct. So I'll show you the right, what it's supposed to be right side. So with the other sections, you'll notice that the little flowers are every other row, or every row is offset. So instead of going straight up, it's offset. So that one's offset. And that one, if I can show you the, okay, so that section down there, you can see, so one here and then offset and one there. And then this section here in the middle, I have them lining up. So get a sec. So I have them, there's three pattern repeats, and I have them just one on top of each other. And as I was knitting it, I thought, oh, I should have offset that one. But I didn't really think about that until I'd finished the second pattern repeat. And I just thought, you know, it looks fine. So I'm just going to leave it. But I think what I'll do in the revision is I will go ahead and instead of having those all in a row, I'll just take the second one and offset it. So that way it'll kind of match with the other sections of the shawl. So I guess that's good news. You know, I'll get to do something that I kind of wanted to do anyway. But I'm not going to work on this right away. It is something that I'm going to give myself some time away from it, some time to work on some other things before I come back to it. But my idea is that I will eventually come back to it and redo it and release it as a separate pattern. But I will kind of target it as a companion to the book. So it won't be in the book, but I will have some type of discount for people who have purchased the book and who then want to purchase the shawl pattern, will be able to get the shawl pattern at a discounted price if they also have the book. So it will be a companion pattern to the book, and it probably, honestly, I probably won't start knitting the sample until definitely after DFW Fiber Fest. So that is in April. And it might even be a little longer than that. So maybe by the end of the year, once I knit the sample, send it to the tech editor, have test knitters, and then, you know, do all of that. It'll probably be toward the end of the year that the shawl, the correct version with the right side up flowers will be released. So anyway, that's the shawl section. Really big disappointment. Like I said, I like how it turned out except for the upside down part. So I will eventually fix it. I just don't have it in me right now to re-knit the entire thing immediately. So I apologize if, for those of you who are looking forward to the shawl pattern, it means it's going to be delayed, but I will, I promise I will come back to it. Just not yet. I'm knitting other things, which I will tell you about in the next section. So part of what kept me motivated while I was working on the shawl was that once I got finished with it, I was going to allow myself to cast on some new projects and to go back to other projects that I've been working on, especially the Heroes of Yarnia scarf. So so I did do those things, and I haven't gotten a lot of work done with Heroes of Yarnia, but I did do a tiny bit. Well, tiny bit, it was a 30 row chart, so pretty big part of it. So there is the section that I knit. This is basically a fox or a kitsune. Is it kitsune or kitsune? I don't know if the E is pronounced. Anyway, so that 30 row chart, that is the part that I knit on this. And I am still in clue two. I think there were eight clues. All of the clues have now been released. So the entire scarf pattern is available. And eventually I will get through it all. Now that I'm kind of taking a break, I don't have a what I'm designing section this time. I'm kind of letting myself take a little bit of a break And knitting all these other things. So hopefully I'll be able to work more on this. I did get myself, I mostly work using an electronic version of patterns. I use Knit Companion. But this, just get kind of keeping track of where you are in the pattern, because there are so many different charts and you roll dice to determine which chart you're going to knit. It's kind of gotten difficult to make sure that I'm you know, keeping up in which place I'm supposed to be. So I noticed one of my friends from my knitting group, she actually had printed out like the entire, all of the clues, the entire pattern, and put it in a binder. So that way she can, you know, she can physically see everything kind of all laid out in front of her. So I took that idea and I printed out the pattern and got a binder. So that way I can do that and refer back to it. And I may actually knit from the binder. I may then kind of use the binder and then use that to go to the chart on Knit Companion. I'm not really sure yet which way I'm going to do that. But hopefully that will help me get a little more progress, because that's as long as mine is so far. Definitely a lot more to go still on that, but that's okay. I don't feel rushed to do it. The designer has created kind of a whole series of quests throughout the year. So some main quests and some side quests. And one of the things that she's doing is the grand quest, which is a blanket. So it is done by squares, and the squares are double knitting. And some of the same charts that are used in the scarf are also in the blanket. And it's a worsted weight blanket. So part of me really wants to do that, but I'm not really sure that I'm ready to jump into it, especially since I'm still got quite a ways to go on the scarf. But that's kind of in the back of my mind, that I'm considering doing that blanket project. So we'll see what happens. And then there is a side quest coming up that I think is a hat in some either fingerless mitts, or maybe they have fingers. I may just do the hat. I probably won't do the gloves or mitts. Anyway, so that is one project that I'm kind of working on. Another project, even though this is yarn I've dyed, I'll just talk about it and what I'm knitting rather than dyeing. So you saw this sock progress. Wow, the lighting here really is not good. Because this is a nice pastel rainbow and it looks kind of washed out in this light. Anyway, so this is a sock sample that I'm working on. I just started decreasing for the toes this morning, and I am going to be putting in an afterthought heel. So right there, that white section is my waist yarn stitches for my afterthought heel. I'm following the smooth operator sock pattern, designer of which just totally slipped my mind, so I will definitely link that in the show notes. And she had three rows. Usually it's one row of waist yarn to put in for an afterthought heel, and she has you put in three. So following what she says, and we'll see how that goes. I have done an afterthought heel before, but it has been years, like, and I don't remember it at all. So I'm almost to the point where I need to do that. Like I said, decreasing for the toes. So once I finish off the sock, I will go back to the heel. And finish that off. I really wanted to do the afterthought heel because since this is kind of a rainbow, I really wanted to keep the color progression going and not lose it on the heel. So we'll see. So that's something I'm working on. And then I have a project I actually started last night. This is, so for the first quarter knit along for this podcast, it is any shawl that has been in your queue or favorites for at least a year. And then if you don't have that, a pattern that's been released at least a year ago. And I started the Elizabeth shawl in a laceweight shawl, and it wasn't working for me. My gauge was too loose. And so I mentioned last time that I ripped that out. And instead of starting that on smaller needles, I decided just to change my project and yarn completely. So I went back to my queue, and I had cleared out my queue earlier last year, and so I didn't have much in there that had been in there for a while. But man, when I looked back at my favorites, I had patterns, especially shawl patterns, that I have saved since, like, you know, 2009, 2010. So I had a lot of choice. And so I found one that seemed like it was a pretty easy, quick knit. And it was one that I remember really wanting to do when it came out, and I just didn't do it. And so the shawl pattern was released in September 2009, and I think it was in my favorites for that long. But it is called Wandering the Moor, and the designer is Celeste Glassell. So let's see. Oh man, the glare here is not... Oh, there we go. So there is the shawl, and then here's a picture, if it'll pop up, that shows a little bit more. There you go. Of the stitch pattern. So back in, you know, 2009, 2010, kind of the shawls mostly started with a plain stockinette, sometimes garter stitch section, and kind of built that plain section, and then the border at the end would be the lace section. It seemed like almost every shawl that was designed was kind of following that same idea. And so that's what this does. So it does stockinette, and you increase until you get to a certain number of stitches, and then you start doing the lace border. And I don't know if you noticed in those pictures, but the yarn that is used is a little bit on the rusticky side. Wandering the Moor, so the idea is, I think it was based on a, is it Bronte or Jane Austen? Oh, the Jane Eyre miniseries, so Bronte. So it was, his shawl was inspired by the shawls worn in the 2006 Jane Eyre miniseries. So I really liked that idea. And so looking at my yarn, it's a sport weight yarn that the pattern calls for, and both my sport weight collection itself, as well as just sport weight that had enough yardage. I didn't have very many options, but I did have, let me grab the label real fast. Okay, I did have, which one is it? This yarn from Sunday Knits. So Sunday Knits Eden. This is listed as a sport weight, and it says that, so I have two skeins and they're 50 gram skeins, so really 100 grams. It says that it's a sport weight, but when you look at it and compare it, it really seems like a fingering weight. It seems kind of thin. And in fact, even though it's classified on Ravelry as sport weight, a lot of the comments actually mention that it seems like it's more of a fingering weight. And so the pattern called for size 6 needles, and I've done fingering weight on size 6 and I've been happy. But I was worried that it might be a little bit too loose, but I decided I would just give it a try. So here's a start. Like I said, it just starts off with stockinette. I just cast this on last night, actually. So here's the start of it. And although it is a little bit airy, I mean, you can kind of see, especially if I stretch it just a tad, you can kind of see the light through it. The one thing that I'm discovering about the yarn is that I think the yarn itself is very, if you're a spinner, the kind of difference in way you spin yarn, you can either spin it woolen or worsted, and worsted is more compact and woolen is more airy. And I think this is kind of more of a woolen type of yarn. It feels very, very airy when I'm knitting it. I can actually kind of tell that it's cushy, squishy, definitely not compact and tight. And so I think that once this gets blocked, it'll actually kind of fluff up a little bit. And a few people actually did mention that in the comments. So I think it'll fluff up a little bit, and that's probably why it is listed as sport weight, even though it looks like fingering weight. Once you block it and it adds that little bit of poof, then I think it'll be sport weight. And I think that if it really does that, I think it fits the idea of that of the pattern, Wandering the Moor, quite well. So I'm really happy. I mean, like I said, I've only got that much done so far, but I'm happy with how that's turning out. So that is my contribution for this quarter's knit along. So hopefully I will have that done by the end of the month, which is when the quarter ends. So I guess my time to encourage you to join in the knit along if you have not already. And make sure that you post in the FO thread if you finish it by the end of the month, so that way you can be entered into the giveaway for this quarter's knit along. And it's probably going to be time pretty soon to start taking nominations. I'll probably do that after the next podcast episode, but be thinking about nominations for themes for the second quarter knit along. So kind of be considering those. And then the big project that I was so excited to cast on and I'm still super duper excited about, Find Your Fade, that it seems like everyone is knitting these days. That seems to be the it project of the moment. And I think one of the most exciting things about the project is that it's designed to use 7 different colors of yarn with the idea that you kind of do a color progression. You start out with one color, and then there's a section that you knit, add in the second color and knit alternating for a little while, and then move on to the second color, and then add in the third color and alternate the second and third color. And so it creates this really neat progression. And I think kind of picking out, picking out the colors of yarn seems to be part of the fun. So on that Saturday when I finished the shawl, before I realized it was upside down, I went through my yarn stash and looked through some options to see what I might choose to do my fade. And I've seen people who did very different colors across their shawl, but I kind of wanted to stick within one color family rather than kind of go almost a rainbow type of scheme. So in looking at my stash, I had a lot of greens and I had a lot of pinks and purples. So those were the two options I decided to kind of focus on. And with the greens, I really liked the last 4 colors. I thought that those would turn out really, really well. But the first 3 that I had in my lineup, and I tried even adding in some blues or some other types of things. The first 3 that I had, I felt were a little too close to one another as far as what they look like, and I would kind of lose any transition. They would really just fade into one another, and I wanted at least a little bit of transition showing. So I turned my attention to the pink and purple options, and that one I felt was a much better option. So I started off, so let me kind of unwrap this and get it so you can see it. So I started off with some yarn that is kind of a gray, but it has a purpley gray tinge to it. And this is some yarn that I picked up when we were visiting some friends in Bloomington, Indiana. So a yarn shop there. So this was a local person. So Robin J. Edmondson. So she had the yarn there, and I picked it up, had no idea at the time what I wanted to make with it, especially because even though it is a fingering weight, it had just 300 yards, and I only bought one skein. Wasn't really thinking too much about that, but that means it turned out perfectly, because then I got to use a good chunk of it at the start of my fade. And actually, let's see, that's... which side is the right side? This is the right side. Okay. So that's the yarn that started out the fade. And then I moved into this next yarn that had gray, but also kind of the pinks and kind of, I guess it's a dark turquoise kind of color. This is a Madeline Tosh yarn. So Tosh Sock. So actually that's the information. Tosh Sock in Steam Age. And that one I had actually used the yarn to knit a shawl for my mother-in-law, and when I only had one skein originally, and as I was getting toward the end of that shawl, I realized to really complete the shawl I needed more yarn. And so fortunately that was when the Mad Tosh store in Fort Worth was still open, And so I just went up to the Madtosh store and picked up a second skein of that colorway, finished off my mother-in-law's scarf or shawl, but then I still had quite a bit of, I think I only used like 5% of the skein, so like 5 grams. So I had almost a full skein left over. So I was really happy to add it in to my fade because I felt that it really transitioned well from that gray. So you can see there's the section where you alternate, and then I move into just that color. And then I picked up the pink from that color and added in the next section. So again, there's the alternating part and then going into the pink. And this yarn, surprise, surprise, is some Julie Spins. And this is a colorway called Deep Rose. So this is yarn that I had in my stash. Actually, it looks like she put the date on here, 109. I've had this in my stash since 09. So really happy to finally have a project that I can use it on. So that's that gorgeous pink color that is in there. And now I have just started adding in the fourth color. So I'm in the alternating section. Actually, I think I just finished the alternating. So I just finished adding in the next color. And now I'll be working solely with that next color. So that one, the color looks like this. So I'm getting the pinks, but I'm kind of going a little bit back toward gray, but there's also some purples in there. So that's the color that's going to be next. And that yarn is from Willy Wonka. So here's Willy Wonka. There you go. Willy Wonka and the colorway is Vamp. Vamp. Anne from Willy Wonka was at DFW Fiberfest 2 years ago, and that's when I picked up this yarn. So that's the one that I added in next. And then upcoming, I have, so I'm going to move into purple. So going from this, I'm going to grab the purples out of that and go into this purple. It's more Julie Spins, and I've had this in my stash since 2009 as well. This is Frosty Grape Jelly is the name of the colorway. So I'm really looking forward to adding that in. And then I'm going to add in this. It has some, so here we go. Actually, this side is a little bit better. It has some of the kind of leading toward the purples there. So moving from that to this. This is MJ Yarns. I try to cover up price tags when I show. Okay, so MJ Yarns. And I got this when we were in Colorado. It is yarn that is actually dyed in Colorado. And I believe it was a yarn shop in Estes Park that we stopped in a yarn shop in Boulder and then also went in Estes Park. And I'm pretty sure it was the Estes Park one that I bought this in. Actually, yes, the price tag has the name of the shop on it. So yes, I bought this in Estes Park. And then the final color, so that'll be the color 6. The final color will grab the really dark purple out of this and blend in with this last color of yarn, a really, really dark purple that is some old school plucky knitter. So old tags, old school plucky knitter that I have had in my stash probably, again, since 2009. So this is the Queen Bella colorway. And I've just wanted to find the perfect project for this yarn and just haven't. And, I know that it means I'm not going to use up the full skein in this project, but that's okay. I will use all the leftovers from this project will go into my leftover sock yarn blanket eventually. they will have a purpose. But anyway, so that is what I'm knitting and working on. Really excited. So kind of showed you bits and pieces. So there is my entire progress so far. So I'm just starting color 4, 7 colors total. This shawl just keeps growing and growing and growing. It's really huge if you've seen a picture of it. It's a really, really big shawl. I think it's a lot of fun. It's very addictive. One of the nice things is that the sections that are not lace are pretty much just garter stitch with a few increases and then a center decrease. So since it's garter stitch, it is a really good project to read and so to read with while I'm knitting. And so I've actually been able to do a lot of reading since I started that project. And so I'll have things to report in the what I'm reading section. But before we do that, have a tiny bit of stashing and then a little bit about yarn dyeing, and then I'll get to what I'm reading. One of the newsletters that I'm subscribed to is called Indie Untangled, and it's basically a place for designers and dyers and other people who do things in the fiber industry to advertise when they have updates and whatnot. In fact, I've advertised on it before. And one of the ones that came out recently advertised for Slipped Stitch Studios, which is a bag maker. So there's Slip Stitch Studios, and I've known Slip Stitch Studios, but I've never purchased a bag from them, even though there have been ones that I've liked. But I saw this one advertised on Indie Untangled, and I basically had to run to my computer because I was reading my phone, getting the update. I had to run to my computer and go order this right away. It's a Princess Bride bag, and I love this fabric. It's basically a bunch of quotes from the Princess Bride. So kind of let you see some of them. Here's the other side. So lots and lots of quotes. I've mentioned before, The Princess Bride is my favorite movie. So really love this bag. I got, this is the two skein project bag. So it has nice bottom. So open up the bottom, nice kind of square bottom. It's pretty big inside, and it has a couple little pockets in there, and then it has a drawstring, and then you can tighten it with that, and then a nice little handle to carry. So I thought this was a really, really fun bag, and definitely had to buy it, and yeah. So that's a little bit of what I'm stashing. Not a whole lot, but I definitely enjoy it. And I need to put a project in here. Actually, I think Wandering the Moor will go in here. It doesn't have a project bag yet. So I think that's the project that will go in here to start off with. So for dyeing, I am pretty much focused on preparation for DFW Fiber Fest. We are just under a month out. It is April 7th through 9th and at the Irving Convention Center. So if you are anywhere near that, so that's in the Dallas area, if you're anywhere near that, I highly recommend coming to the Fiber Festival. It's a really, really great festival. The vendor hall is incredible. There are still some classes that have spaces open if you want to take a class, and it's a really, really great time. So you should make it if you are anywhere nearby. It's even worth traveling to, honestly. So I'm preparation for that is pretty much my focus. I actually have a little notebook where I've got my dyeing schedule, where I make a list of the things that I need to still dye, in preparation for the festival. And right now my focus is pretty much on the self-striping. So there's my list of Merlin self-striping that I still need to dye. So there's still quite a bit on that list there. That I still need to work through to get ready for the festival, but I've kind of got my routine kind of set up, and I'm moving forward pretty nicely. So hopefully I will be able to get it all done. I am working on a FiberFest exclusive colorway. It is a 4-stripe colorway, and this blue is one of those 4 stripes. And this is actually a set of mini skeins. So if you want to do your heels and toes a solid color, then this is the colorway that will go with that exclusive. Anyway, I will be revealing the entire 4 colors of the 4-color striping in my newsletter that comes out next week on Tuesday. Excuse me. So if you are interested in finding out what the entire DFW FiberFest exclusive colorway looks like, make sure you are subscribed to my newsletter. I will link to that in the show notes, and you will find that on Tuesday's newsletter. And so pretty much that is what I am dying. I am really deep into prep for FiberFest. especially the self-striping. I have a yarn club shipment that goes out next week. I did the dyeing for that shipment last month, so that way I knew I didn't want to have to run into the stress of trying to do that, as well as DFW Fyber Fest prep. So that is ready to go. And otherwise, that's pretty much what I'm going to be doing. Mostly self-striping, maybe a little bit of other stuff. And then in just under a month, we'll have a DFW Fyber Fest. So I'm really excited. I actually have a book review. So I've actually mentioned the book in the last podcast. So it is, and this is actually the inner cover, not the photo cover. So Coffee with Cece and Dami Too, so a mother-daughter team. It is a pattern collection of 7 patterns, as it says, inspired by caffeine, or caffeine-inspired. 5 of the patterns are socks. One is this really pretty rectangular wrap, and then the other one is some fingerless mitts. So all of these were inspired by a specific caffeine-related drink. And just full disclosure, this is a review. I did receive a free copy for this review, but I also received a free copy because some of my yarn was used in as the yarn in one of the patterns. So full disclosure there that I did really like the book, but there could be some bias right there because of that. So I will let you know that. Anyway, so it starts off with the contents. So you can see these on Ravelry, but there are 4 of the patterns. So there are the socks, and then here are the last 3. So you've got the wrap, another sock, and then there are the fingerless mitts. So one of the things that I really liked, oh, actually, I like this photo. I have to show you this photo. So there's the wrap and all the other projects kind of folded and stacked. I really like the way that photo turned out. So one of the things that I really like about this book is that the sock patterns, you get instructions for both toe up and cuff down socks. I'm definitely a cuff down sock knitter. And so whenever I see socks that are toe up, I usually, even if they look really great, and even though I know I probably could do some type of conversion to make them cuff down, I usually kind of pass over those patterns that only offer toe up. So I think it's a really nice advantage to this book that you get both sets of instructions. So that way, if you like to do them toe up, you've got your instructions, you can do it. If you'd like to do them cuff down, you can follow those. You don't have to worry about converting or possibly bypassing the book because it doesn't do your preferred set of sock instructions. So I think that's a really great benefit of the book. One of the other things about the book, the way the patterns are written, is that they are specifically written for magic loop. So that's when you have one really long circular needle and you basically kind of have 2 halves of the sock, and then you have the loop that stays out to kind of separate those 2 halves, and so you can use that one long needle for the sock. So the instructions are written as, needle 1, do this, needle 2, do that. So that is something to keep in mind. If you do not use magic loop, that doesn't mean that you cannot knit these socks. You just have to do a slight bit of conversion there. So if you use double pointed needles instead, I would recommend that you use a set of 5 double pointed needles so that you have 4 working needles and then or 4 needles that your stitches are on and then 1 working needle. That way, needle 1 in the pattern would be needles 1 and 2 of your DPNs, and needle 2 in the pattern would be needles 3 and 4 of your DPNs. I think it would be a lot easier to convert the pattern that way than if you were to try to use a set of 4 DPNs only with 3 that have stitches and then your 1 working. I always knit my socks with a set of 5 DPNs. So I think that conversion would be pretty easy, but I do want to kind of mention that in case you're not a magic looper, just so you're not kind of thrown if you look at the patterns and wonder what's going on. So the first pattern starts out with the baby chino socks, and these are actually, so baby chino, these are actually baby socks, so teeny tiny socks there, and I think that's really, really cute. And the sizing, she actually does give you, and this is one that was actually designed by Dami, so the daughter. She does actually give you baby all the way to adult large sizing. So even though they're called baby chino, they're not just baby socks. You can do whatever size, basically. In fact, it says baby, toddler, child, adult, small, medium, and large. So there's six sizes for this sock, which is really great because you can make some matching socks with you and your child. So, which is something that one of you guys mentioned you're doing some matching socks for you and your son, which I thought was a really great idea. So Cameron, I'm probably gonna take that idea and do the same thing with my son. But this would be a pattern that you could easily do that with, since you have sizing for the different size feet. So that's really, really great. And then I also like on all of the patterns, they give a difficulty level. Oh, come on. Why does that really not want to show? There we go. A difficulty level, and it's based upon how many cups of coffee your difficulty level is. So it's 1, 2, or 3 cups of coffee. And so that one is a kind of more beginner type of level. And then, like I said, they give both toe up and cuff down versions. And then the next one is the instant coffee socks. So there you go. I really like the stitch pattern on that one. It says it's a slipped stitch pattern. So it says that these are easy and quick to make, just like instant coffee. And I think not just are they easy and quick to make, but I think the stitch pattern just looks really nice. So if they're easy and quick, then you end up with something that looks really great at the end. And again, the sizing here, they have small, medium, and large. So not baby sizing here, but at least a little range of sizes for adults. Toe up and cuff down. Then we have the espresso con panna socks. So there's the name. Here is the picture. And this is a, she says, I've replicated the look of an espresso con panna using a textured pattern to represent the coffee's foam with the whipped cream on top. So that's kind of a nice little connection there. This is a difficulty level of 2 coffee cups. And there is a chart as well as written instructions. So she provides both for whichever way you would prefer to go, which is really nice addition. And then again, toe up or cuff down. And then the next one is the chai latte, which I showed you guys last time, which is using my yarn. So that is my Archimedes colorway. And so that one, she uses slip stitches again, and then based upon where the stripes break up in your self-striping yarn, this one is designed specifically for self-striping, then that's when you you base the pattern on your stripes, so it really is customizable, so that's really nice. And then again, it has a small chart if you want to use a chart, or it also has it written out completely if you want to do that. And then the next pattern in the book is the flat white wrap. And this, I think, is really nice rectangular wrap that, there we go, that has a pretty lace design. And it says that the wrap pattern can be modified to create a wider or skinnier wrap, a skinnier scarf, or a cowl. So if you don't want the wrap as written, you can definitely do some modifications. And again, here there is a small chart, or you can have the written instructions. And then there is the hot chocolate with pink marshmallows socks. And if you know Cece at all, pink is her favorite color. Her hair is pink, and like a lot of stuff that she has is pink. Definitely think it's fun that she had the pink marshmallows in there. Anyway, here is that sock pattern, and it has kind of these X's and O's in the design. And this one is a higher difficulty level. It does have three coffee cups here, but I think mostly that is because it has some cables. So if you are comfortable with cables, then that you should probably be fine with this pattern. And again, you can either follow the chart or you can follow the written instructions. And I really like those little X's and O cables. And again, cuff down or toe up, depending on which one you like. And then this one, I believe this is the last pattern, is the fingerless mitts. And it's the one shot, two shot, three shots fingerless mitts. And the reason for that is because the pattern, the pattern gives you options for multiple sizes. So if you notice, there are actually three different sizes in this picture. So you can do kind of a long, a short, or a kind of a mid-range size there. And it says basically it depends on how many times you repeat the cable pattern. So again, this one has cables, so the difficulty level is three coffee cups, but looking at the cable chart, if you've done cables before, they're really not super hard cables. So if you're comfortable with cables at all, then I think you would be completely comfortable with this pattern, even at a three coffee cup difficulty level. And again, both charted and written instructions based upon how, and then, you know, how long you want your fingerless gloves to be. So this is, and then they've got abbreviations in the back. Here's the little difficulty level. And I like how they've got light, medium, and strong. She really does carry that coffee kind of theme throughout the book. So I really like that. There is little about them section at the end. So here they are, mother and daughter design team, who are also podcasters. And yeah, I think that this is a really fun book. I have not done patterned socks in a while. I mostly, since I'm doing self-striping, I mostly just do kind of the plain vanilla sock. But I think that there are some fun sock patterns in this book. Definitely the one that a little partial to, but the chai latte one, since it is developed for self-striping, I want to give that a try with some self-striping in my stash. I also really like the, now I can't remember which one it is, the instant coffee one, the texture on the instant coffee. I think that that's a really nice sock pattern. So that's another one that I probably would want to knit myself. I think the wrap is gorgeous as well. So maybe I'll get to that as well someday. But I think it's a really nice pattern collection. And it actually just came out on Ravelry today. So if you are watching this, well, even if you're watching this later, it is now available. It was in pre-order for a while, but it actually was released today. So you can go to Ravelry and get your own copy. Or if you want, so if you want to get your own copy, definitely do that. Or CC is generous enough to provide me with one copy, the electronic copy, so PDF version of the ebook collection to give away to one of you guys. So I have another giveaway. So I will have a thread in the Ravelry group for the podcast. So t-shirts and shawls, t-shirts and shawls podcast Ravelry group. And I will link in the show notes to that. And it will be a thread that will open basically when this episode goes live. And then I will close it the night before I film the next episode, which again, I should look at the calendar to see what date that is. So I will have the thread open for 2 weeks. And I just want you to go to the thread if you would like to enter the giveaway. Tell me which of these seven patterns would you want to cast on first? So if you do win the pattern collection, which one are you going to actually cast on first? So the next podcast episode will be filmed on March 23rd. So I will close the giveaway thread at the end of the day on March 22nd. So you have between now and March 22nd, 2017, to enter the giveaway for one PDF copy of this collection of caffeine-inspired knitting projects, which I really enjoyed looking through, and I am looking forward to knitting at least one of the projects from the book. So go to Ravelry, enter the giveaway, and we'll see who gets the collection. If you don't want to wait, then go ahead and buy your copy of the collection now. All right, it's time to do the giveaway for the lace weight yarn. So I'm going to the thread on Ravelry, and I see that there are 19 replies. I am number one, so what I've done is I've gone to random.org and put numbers 2 through 19. So it's going to generate number between 2 and 19. We're going to start with the black alpaca. So the winner of the black alpaca is generate number 7. And we go down here to post number 7. And Tim, you have won the black alpaca. So congratulations, Tim. Make sure that you send me a PM with your address, and I will send you the black alpaca. The second yarn is the green Julie spins. And for that one, again, between numbers 2 and 19, we generate and we get the result of 10. 10, if we scroll on down, is a simple motif. So that is Erica. So Erica, congratulations. You get the green Julie spins. In fact, that is the one that in this post you said that you wanted. So that's fantastic. Congratulations. Again, send me a PM. And then finally, we have the brown plucky alpaca, or plucky knitter. Brown plucky knitter, somewhere between 2 and 19. Generate, and we get 12. Who is number 12? Post number 12 is PTM Smith. So Mary, congratulations. You have won the brown plucky knitter. And I see in this post here that you would do this cowl with that lace weight yarn. So send me a PM with your address and I will get that yarn to you. Congratulations for all of you who won the lace weight yarn. And I look forward to sending you your yarn and seeing what you make with it. So I haven't put all of the segments together for this episode yet, but just looking at the times that I've been recording each segment, I'm pretty sure this is going to add up to over an hour already without this what I'm reading / watching section. So I think I will kind of try to, I've read quite a bit over the past 2 weeks, but I think I'll try to kind of go through somewhat quickly. I don't have a ton to say on each book, but I think I'll kind of go through them. So I have been listening to several books since I've been doing a bunch of prep for the self-striping yarn. I usually am listening to audiobooks while I'm doing that. So that has helped me get through quite a few books. So one of the ones that I read, and I wrote down a list of what I read, but I didn't put down the authors. So one of the books that I read is called Followed by Frost, and it's the same author that did the Paper Magician series. So I believe it's Charlie, last name starts with an H. I will put this in the show notes for sure. So I listened to that book. As far as I know, it's a standalone book. I haven't looked to see. Maybe there's a sequel, but I'm pretty sure it's a standalone. But it's kind of a fairy tale type of thing. It's a girl who basically is pretty self-absorbed, pretty arrogant, and she, there's a guy who is in love with her and proposes to her, and she completely turns him down, but in such a way that's kind of cruel. And unfortunately for her, he actually is a magician, and he curses her and basically says that she will be so followed by frost, that she will be followed by a cold that is as cold as her heart. And so pretty much she herself is always cold, and she has this kind of, I guess, cloud that follows her, and if she stays in one place for too long, it starts to snow and it gets really cold. and to the point of, you know, the conditions are so bad that she can't be around other people for very long because it's actually dangerous for other people to have kind of that much snowfall. So she's forced to leave her home and to go on a journey, basically trying both to survive, which means not being around other people and endangering them, and potentially to find a way to break the curse. So not going to give away, you know, anything that happens, but I'll just say it's a really good kind of figuring out who she is, figuring out her place in the world, and figuring out whether or not she can break this curse. And so I really enjoyed listening to that book. So I highly recommend it. I really enjoyed the Paper Magician series. So I also recommend that if you haven't read that. So that was good. And then I am in the third book of a trilogy. It is the Red Queen trilogy. This is Victoria Aveyard, who is one of the authors I saw at the North Texas Teen Book Festival. So the first book is called Red Queen. And the second is The Glass Sword. And the third one, which I'm listening to now, is called King's Cage. So the idea in these books is that there is a society in which you either have, and you physically have either red blood or silver blood. And the people who have silver blood usually have abilities. So you can kind of think of them as magical powers, but they seem to be somewhat a bit more than that. So like the ruling king, his ability is to create flame. And then there are also, you know, mind readers, people who can make themselves invisible, people who can basically take metal and shape it, like use their mind to kind of shape it and form it and control it. So all these abilities, and I mean, obviously people with abilities are probably the ones that are going to rule, and that is indeed what happens. And so they are the ruling class, and then the reds, so people with red blood who don't have abilities, are basically the ones who really are kind of repressed. And the main character is a red. And she, basically through a series of events, goes to the palace, and she's a servant, and through an accident, is kind of discovered that she has abilities. She's a red, but she has an ability like a silver. So it's this very, like, how did that happen? Type of thing. And her ability, she's able to kind of control electricity and lightning. So it's a really interesting ability. And so it starts off with basically the silvers trying to, the king and queen trying to contain this information because they don't want it to get out that this red has abilities. And so they make up this whole story and say that she's actually a silver who was lost at birth and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so that's kind of the setup to the story. And as you might expect, you've got this group of people who are repressed. They're going to rise up and rebel, and indeed, that is what is happening. And she obviously is kind of this crossover between the red and the silver, is a very important part to play in the rebellion. So it's very much a dystopian type of book, and I really like the main character. She's definitely a very flawed character. She makes mistakes. She makes decisions that that have very serious consequences, but overall, you know, she's a character that's someone that is pretty easy to identify with and connect with. So I really am enjoying her story. So that's one that I really liked. And then as far as what I am physically reading, I finished Strangers in Their Own Land. And which I mentioned a few times, and there is actually stuff that I want to say about that, but because I know this episode is going to run long, I'm actually going to hold that off for hopefully the next episode. So I'll come back to that. But I've been reading, so one of the authors I met at the, or I didn't meet, I listened to in the panel, at the North Texas Teen Book Festival was Kirsten White. And she has quite a few books out, several series, but one of the ones she mentioned is called Paranormalcy, and it's a trilogy. And what she mentioned is that that it's kind of there's a lot of humor involved in it, in the paranormal book. And so just the way she was describing it, and just her demeanor herself, I thought was someone that I would probably really enjoy reading her book. And at first I didn't actually realize it was a trilogy. I just thought it was one book. So when I got back from the book festival, I actually went straight to my Kindle, and I bought Paranormalcy, discovered it's actually a trilogy, and I started reading that one. And sure enough, it definitely is kind of a lighter book, as far as it has a lot of humor in it, although there's some seriousness to it. It is a young adult book, and so a lot of it is kind of a coming of age type of thing. The main character trying to kind of figure herself out. She is a paranormal, but she is very different from any other paranormal. And she's not entirely sure what she is, because, you know, there's been no one like her. So trying to figure out what she is, and then there is a threat to the paranormal community that she has to kind of do her part to counteract. And I finished the first book. I finished it, I think, yesterday. And I got the second book right away. Really, that's one thing I really like about reading on the Kindle, that I'm able to, hey, I just finished the book. Now I can jump in and immediately go into the next book. So I'm reading the second book, and just started that one last night. And as far as I can tell so far, I should, when I finish that one, jump to the third book. And then I think I will also be giving other books by this author a try. She has a completely different set of books. I think it's two books. Maybe there will be three, but two books right now that are kind of about Vlad Dracul. But instead of being Vlad Dracul, it actually turns Dracula into a teenage girl. Still set in the, as far as I am aware, still set in that time. So she's a very, very vicious and violent character. I'm not really sure how that necessarily plays out, but I think that's kind of an intriguing idea. And so I will probably at some point give that book a try. And then she has a couple of other books that look good. So I think that's an author that I was kind of introduced to at the book festival that I'm excited about and am enjoying so far. So at least at this point, I would recommend at least Paranormalcy. And again, I will link to all these in the show notes. So like I said, I've been doing quite a bit more reading, both listening to books and reading on the Kindle. So that's been fun. I was kind of in a book slump for a while, so it's nice to get out of that slump and to be excited about reading. As far as what I'm watching, the only thing I want to mention there is that I'm semi-watching Legion, so a new show. It's in the superhero Marvel universe, and one of the things that I am, I'm not really like sitting down and watching it. It's something my husband's watching, and if I'm in the room, then I'm watching it. And if I miss it, then I miss it. Which, with this show, if you miss something, it's probably not a good thing, because there's a lot going on and it's kind of complicated. So I'm really quite lost, to be honest. We watched a little bit last night, I guess the latest episode, and I don't fully understand what's going on. But one of the reason I want to bring it up is that the main character is played by Dan Stevens. And I knew that name sounded familiar. I mean, I know he's in the live action Beauty and the Beast that's coming out. But I'm like, but why, you know, why is that familiar? And I'm, you know, looking at the actor as I'm watching Legion, and I'm like, I'm not placing him. Why am I not placing him? And then it clicked. Dan Stevens played Matthew Crawley on Downton Abbey. And oh my gosh, the character in Legion could not be more different from Matthew Crawley. And yes, there's a little bit. I mean, the hairstyle is different and a little bit and whatnot. But I think it just really shows how good of an actor Dan Stevens is that to me, the Matthew Crawley character is really a very specific character who I really liked. And I'm not going to say anything about Downton Abbey and the character in case you have not watched Downton Abbey and want to. I don't want to spoil anything. It's so remarkably different that he's completely unrecognizable in this role. Now I can kind of start to see it a little bit, but it's still really hard to see the same actor as those two characters since they are so different. So good job, Dan Stevens and the acting department for being able to take on these two completely different roles in such a convincing way. So I just wanted to comment on that because that was really surprising to me. And then also, I really, really love Beauty and the Beast. So I am looking forward to seeing the live action version of the movie. Do need to find a babysitter for Luke because I don't necessarily think it would be a bad movie to take Luke to. I think that that he would probably be okay with seeing it. But it's mostly because I want to enjoy the movie and I don't want to have to worry about making sure Luke is staying in a seat and staying quiet and paying attention to the movie. I want to be able to immerse myself in the movie. So if my husband and I want to go see it, need to see if my mom or my sister or my niece or someone can watch Luke so we can go see it. So hopefully we'll be able to do that at some point. But I definitely want to see that movie because I really, really love Beauty and the Beast. Anyway, I said I was going to go through this pretty quickly, but I see by the time that it's still getting quite extensive in the time. So I will go ahead and end that now. Hopefully continue my staying out of my book slump and reading a lot more and having more to share with you next time. So there was a lot going on in this episode. If you watched all the way to the end, thank you so very much for watching. If you are a new viewer, thank you for checking me out, checking out the podcast. I hope you will come back. If you are a returning viewer, thank you so much for coming back each time and watching the podcast. If you would like to talk about anything on the podcast, feel free to go to the Ravelry group, T-shirts and Shawls podcast on Ravelry. I'll link to it in the show notes. There will be a discussion thread for this episode, so feel free to jump in there. If you have something you'd like to say that's not tied to a particular episode, there is a general discussion thread. Make sure you go to the giveaway thread if you would like to possibly win a PDF copy of the Coffee with CC book. And make sure, if you haven't already, that you hit the subscribe button, whether you're watching this on YouTube or on iTunes. If you hit subscribe, then you will get notified anytime there is a new episode, so that way you won't miss one. And I'd also really appreciate it if you like the episode, if you're on YouTube, if you just hit that thumbs up underneath the episode, so that way you show other people that you like it and that you recommend it. Definitely helps with trying to get new viewers, which I appreciate anyone new or returning who sits and watches this episode and kind of shares about an hour or so, sometimes more, with me talking about knitting and reading and geeky types of things. And with that in mind, I will see you guys in 2 weeks with more knitting and reading and geeky things. Bye, and happy knitting.